Hello, everyone. Welcome to Build. I'm your host, Brittany Jones Cooper. The film Juliet Naked is a charming romantic comedy that follows a woman in a complicated love triangle with her long-term boyfriend and the obscure rock star that he's obsessed with. The film is funny and relatable, due in large part to stellar performances by Rose Byrne and Chris O'Dowd, who are both here with us today. We'll also be joined by the movie's director, Jesse Peretz. But before we bring them out, let's check out the trailer from Juliet Naked.
I may look like a nice English lady in a sensible cardigan, but these days it's a thin veneer and it's starting to crack.
Who wants to bring kids into this bloody world?
My point is, I just don't think that the world needs more kids.
I think we get it.
Tucker Crowe, one of the most unsung figures of alternative rock, hasn't been seen in 20 years.
That's him.
Wow, he's so gorgeous.
Thank you.
I think I've had enough Tucker bloody Crowe to last 20 lifetimes.
Tucker has a new album, and I don't want to spend my time with someone who doesn't get it.
Well, somebody new.
Juliet Naked is a naked attempt to squeeze a few more quid out of a long dead career.
You wrote this.
It was the strangest thing. I met someone on the internet. You're finally entering the modern age. You read that review I posted.
You nailed it. I couldn't have explained it better myself. Tucker Crowe.
Tucker Crowe, as in Duncan's idol, Tucker Crowe.
Yeah, it's really me. What's your story?
Dear Tucker, it's really odd to be saying all this to a stranger, but I have a hunch I've wasted the last 15 years of my life.
I don't imagine this is much of a consolation, but I'm ashamed to say that 2 decades have slipped through my fingers.
At least you have a past to live up to.
Big news, I'm coming to London. Would you like to meet for a drink?
Waiting outside where you find your key.
Beautiful spot.
You're not downstairs, are you?
That's me and my high school chess club.
I can explain this. I'm not trying to trap you. Or cut your head off or whatever.
Hey! How have you been?
Duncan Thompson.
Tucker Crowe.
I'm Stevie Wonder.
Just take it.
Real mature, Annie.
What are you drinking, Tucker Crowe?
Glass of water.
I'm not getting a famous American rock star a glass of water.
I'm not that famous, okay? And I'm an alcoholic.
Well, you'll fit right in.
I was wondering if you'd be interested in me.
Do you think there's any way back for me?
You sure this doesn't have something to do with your idol coming along and fancying me?
Please. How do we know that's even him?
Well, I have a passport.
Well, that would be super.
Well, all of this seems to be in order.
Really?
Oh, thank God.
Everyone, put your hands together for Rose Byrne, Chris O'Dowd.
Thank you.
And Jesse Peretz.
Thank you.
So, first I'll say, I love this film for many reasons. The first is that I'm like a rom-com girl. But this is so much more than that. It has this heart, and it's quirky, and it's fun. So, I just want to say, like, there's so many different romantic comedies out there, but this one really kind of stuck out to me. So I think it's going to be
that's very kind.
Well received. Yeah. So Jesse, I'll start with you. How did you get your hands on, I mean, I know Nick Hornby wrote the book, but how did you kind of get your hands on this project?
Well, the truth of the matter is that the producers of this film had already like bought the book and had like a script when they brought it to me, but I read that draft and I really liked that draft. But then I immediately read the book and I loved the book, and I saw a slightly different movie in the book than the one that of the script that I'd read. And and in all honesty, at that point in time, it was 2 weeks after having directed this guy in an episode of Girls, and not to embarrass you, but I was so obsessed with his improv prowess and how funny he was, and I was thinking in my head, I need to find something to do with Chris O'Dowd. And I got to page 20 of the script, and I thought, okay, Duncan is Chris O'Dowd. that was a big driving force of like jumping into this project, was like, oh, hopefully I'll be able to get Chris O'Dowd to play that
character. And the premise is so original. The fact that it's Duncan, who was so obsessed with Tucker Crowe, and then Annie ends up falling in love. And it's like this very complicated love triangle I've never seen before. So is that what drew you guys to the project?
Yes. I mean, to me, it felt quite normal in that a lot of the people I fall in love with are people that I've been fans of in the past that I've then entrapped in my house. And it's gone on from there. But I was definitely drawn to work with Rose, which we had very briefly done before on Bridesmaids. And like Jesse said, we had just worked together and had fun on Girls. And Ethan Hawke seemed like the wild card. And of course, it was produced by Judd Apatow's company that I was familiar with. So it was an easy one, really, to jump onto. And I'm glad I did.
I had read the novel in 2009 and just loved it. It's my favorite Nick Hornby novel. So when I found out it was becoming a film, I just, you know, threw my hat in the ring straight away and met with Jesse quite early on. And yeah, you said yesterday that you get such a gift with the novel, with the characters already. So trying to bring that to life was
exactly
the sort of the challenge. Yeah.
And I love the characters so much because I feel like I know people in real life like them. You know what I mean? Which it's super relatable and you can identify with them, especially, you know, Annie and Duncan's character. They've been in this long-term relationship that isn't quite as ideal as it used to be. And was that something, I mean, your guys' chemistry was so amazing. And is it because you've worked together in the past or what kind of work did you do just to, because the comedic timing, everything was just so insane.
I think our sensibilities are similar.
Yeah. Yeah.
We find the same stuff funny and we find each other funny. or pretend to. So that was relatively easy. I believed our relationship from the start. It just felt like we should be a couple, you know.
Trying to tell us something? Or
you know, if like if things had turned out differently. but yeah, I definitely know characters like these, and Duncan is very familiar to me. It's most men I know who kind of define themselves by the things they like rather than their actual behavior. you know, we are kind of drowning in content of different kinds, and to be able to ring fence your own personality amongst a few different things seems somehow easier to maintain.
Well, that's the thing. For him, it's Tucker Crowe, but for so many other guys, it's like fantasy football or like whatever right. it is that their partner is just like, what is this? I don't understand it. Yeah, so I love that they chose an actual another person that's like this obscure
And for
artist.
Women, it's like riding horses. I don't know that many women.
Macrame.
Yes.
So Rose, talk to me a little bit about Annie. She walks around with this like quiet grace, but it seems like she is also just struggling with so much internally at the same time.
Yeah, and she's sandwiched between these two personalities, big personalities, so it was important to just make sure... Which, you know, being in Jesse's hands was such a relief because he's so great, particularly with female protagonists, to make sure she was, like, clearly defined and not just a wallflower because she's sort of shy, you know, but she's very witty, she's very smart, and she's breaking all the rules in her life at this in the film. She's rebelling against everything and protesting and breaking out and taking a risk finally. So it's kind of, yeah, it's sort of... reminds me a lot of people in my life who I know as well who sort of finally take risks and do things. So it's kind of, yeah, it's quite an emotional journey for her.
There's a lot of like themes of, I kind of noticed that we watched it last night and I hadn't really seen it finished before. And there's a lot of themes of mortality in it. You know, there's because there's a lot of birth and then you work in a museum.
Yeah.
That's all, really.
Specifically with the photo, Tucker the woman kind of talking about, you know, she's in her 80s now. And
that's right. And
she never took a risk.
And I think the catalyst for him becoming a recluse, of course, is a baby, without giving too much of it away. And Annie feels, I think, like her life hasn't really taken off, which I think most people can relate to. Mm. So that's interesting to get your little teeth into.
I mean, each of the three main characters were all in their own crisis at the same time. And it was fun to watch how they bounced off each other and helped each other. So for you, how fun was that just to play with these different characters and
well,
scenes?
I mean, you know, first of all, I just felt like so lucky to have these three actors to play with and kind of explore who these characters were. And it was one of the things that was very interesting representing our missing compadre Ethan here. It was really funny that we were, and I when I say we, my sister was the writer for the draft once I got involved with the project, and we were obsessed with trying to make sure that Tucker was like redeemable and good enough that like the audience would sort of feel good about her you know, having feelings for him, and I don't want to give away too much. But we had almost like written too we had like kind of made him too good, and it was really interesting when Ethan showed up in England. We shot the whole film in England, and when he showed up a week beforehand, he came in with a strong take that he could be much more of a sort of rascally, mischievous, kind of no good guy, and he was like, "I promise you, like, I'll make people feel okay about it. I'll work it through." I believe he really was right. I don't know whether everyone will, but definitely he made that part more fun to watch, and you know,
He does toe that line. I mean, this is personal. My brother is very much like that character, and it's like he's kind of this lovable fuck up. It's like you still find yourself rooting for him, even though you can see sort of like the path of destruction he's left over the past 20 or so years. I think he did kind of balance that perfectly, where you still wanted him to have a happy ending and to kind of be the father he always wanted to be, despite all of the issues that he had.
I mean, that was the goal. So
yeah,
you kind of forgive Ethan for anything, because even when
he's so cute,
he's so docile. You can always still imagine him like standing on a desk, you know. Oh, captain, my captain. And so he can cheat on loads of women in a movie, and it's fine.
That hospital scene, take me through that, because for me that was just genius. It was like
that was pretty epic. That was pretty epic.
That was probably one of the hardest scenes to shoot. It was a lot.
It was a seven and a half page scene, which for people who don't know, that's a very long scene, and that's a very long day. And we had 10, 11 characters. So it's even more when it's 7.5 pages with like needing to get coverage of all the different characters. But it came together pretty amazingly. And Ethan, I will say, kind of really seems like I'm singing his praises hardcore with you guys here. But he really, like, it was so much dialogue, and he just came in there, and he was like a rock in the middle of that scene. And we at least had three cameras that day, and we just had to work our way around the room, and his energy just keep it going. And but it was really fun, though. You know, the whole rest of our cast in that scene were all, except for Ozzy, the kid, were British actors, even actually except for Carrie, who plays his wife. But it was a pretty epic.
The scene, for those who haven't seen it, is kind of where a lot of his different worlds collide for the first time, and it's the first time your character's meeting him. And I actually, for me, you were the breakout of that scene because of your just awkwardness. Was so oh my god! I was like, yes, you just want
to.
You
so just uncomfortable to watch, and she's just constantly trying to get out of the situation. He's like, no, just stay. And she's like, I don't know. It's like so. It's very funny, but it's hard to watch. Yeah, you're like, oh my god, and it just escalates, and yeah. It was very funny. And I remember shooting it, there was like an energy of like everybody was laughing for the first few hours. And then by the end of the day, we were pretty knackered. But.
Except for the two weird English twins who were trying to say their one word in an American accent.
Was that a struggle for them?
It was an easy word to dub. Let's put it there. Easy word. Said fly, and the other one said plane. But it still sounded very English.
Another of one of your co-stars that really I loved was Jackson. He plays the little boy. So what were scenes like with him? Because he seems like a very professional, like, actor. He had a lot of dialogue and a lot of roles, and I feel like he nailed it. You had a lot of scenes with him.
He was adorable. I mean, and children are always daunting because you're not quite sure. You don't know, and you've got limitations, and as you should. But it's daunting. But he was a pro. He was always really good.
Yeah, he stole really quite a lot of stuff from the set.
He was a thief, but he's a criminal. He's a criminal.
Just like chairs and stuff. I know he didn't. I know he had this weird chair fetish. I didn't want to get into him with it.
But nobody confronts a kid when he's
stealing
chair.
You can't. Not with the new laws and everything. It's difficult. You can't Dicey. Confront kids.
Yeah.
But no, he's so terrific in it.
He's really cute.
I hadn't really worked with him on the thing, but he was at the premiere last night, and he was He was pretty drunk. It was.
He really was.
He's living his best life.
I also wanted to talk about some of the blocking in the movie. You had a lot of bags, covering things, and I was like, "Were you pregnant during?"
Where is she going? She got all these bags with her.
But this is only because my job is to literally watch so much TV and movies, and
I may have been. I may.
Yeah.
I may have been 6 months pregnant.
Yeah. So what was that experience like for you?
What
and for you?
Crazy.
And then for you, kind of blocking and figuring out ways.
It was a major component. I remember when we had lunch and she first broke it to me, probably maybe even before before Bobby. No, I felt like it was very, very,
Bobby
very,
doesn't
very
know,
early.
But.
And I think you thought I was going to freak out, but
I did.
My instant reaction.
The character's so not pregnant. That's the thing. It's like she's so not pregnant. So it's not like
my instant reaction was, this will be good. She'll be a little like fuller, and it'll make her seem. It will help Rose play the more homely character that I wanted Annie to be. And so I was full positive about it. But then I didn't really think through like how many months. Like when we met was like around 6 weeks, and I didn't realize how many more months it would be. And.
Right.
And even though I've had 3 kids, I forgot all about that. But it was nice. I've always wanted to shoot something CinemaScope, like full wide. And the nice thing was I was able to use her pregnancy as a as an excuse to shoot a wider frame, because basically we could mostly only shoot from here up. Right. And so it allowed us to give you to trick the audience into thinking you were looking at a medium shot when really it was just a... Basically, we had medium close-ups and close-ups of Rose.
That was it.
And a couple of body.
But now every time you look at the movie, you have a nice memory.
I do.
Right?
And then halfway through the movie, I put my finger in a blender.
That's fun.
And that was awesome. And so I had a huge bandage because my finger came off and I had to put it back on. And I had a huge bandage. So it was like... Finger down, put the hand down over the stomach, so it's just like another thing to avoid.
Right. Yeah. Remember your lines.
Yeah. So, yeah, that
poor thing.
Yeah, shocker. Such
what
a shame.
What are you doing?
I was making muffins very late at night, and I was just rabidly obsessed about this recipe. And then the butter got stuck. It was one of those hand blenders, and I was like, "Oh, why is it stuck?" And I put my finger in.
This will help.
This woman's like, and it was a shame. Yeah.
Because you couldn't then probably finish the muffins, which is the worst part of it.
Oh man, they never saw the light of day. They were just a mixture. Yeah, it was awful. So
that's how they make red velvet.
Whoa!
Little known fact.
That's fact.
You're here all week.
So I get my dough.
So one more thing about the film that I really love before we go to audience questions is sort of the turmoil it put me in as a viewer between like a physical infidelity and emotional infidelity. And I feel I won't say who did what in the film, whatever, but I just love how I kind of was siding more with one, and then I was like, well, wait, they're both kind of guilty in the demise of the relationship in their own way. Any thoughts on that?
I think it's always two people it's always two people's responsibility to keep something together or when it falls apart. Whether someone's cheated, but it's like, well, it would have fallen apart already before they did that. Do you know what I mean? Like,
I do.
I think it's a very...
Yeah.
And their relationship has just deteriorated. I mean, it's become an artifact, literally, like the rest of her life. It's just this relic. And
yes. I think that's true.
But he did cheat.
Well, one of the characters cheats. And I think that's probably somebody. I think if you sleep with someone, even if you're unhappy, you should get out. You should get out. Like, if you I think by cheating with someone, it does make it. I think it's worse. I do think it's worse.
Of course.
Yeah.
In no way saying good idea, but
for the record, Rose is advocating
for the record
cheating. If there's a bump in your relationship and you feel like you're not, how else are you gonna find out?
Exactly.
Sometimes
it
can
That's
help,
it, guys.
You know. Sometimes,
yeah, sometimes it just livens things up.
And I'm curious, there is this really great scene where Duncan gets to meet his idol, and it ends up being sort of they always say never meet your idols. So have you guys have any interest, like, interactions with fans who, like, think they really know you and you're like, oh, dude, like, I'm not Helen from Bridesmaids. You know what I mean? Like, I'm an actual person. And how do you deal with that?
But you kind of are.
Are you? Funny thing is. She's really uptight. I've never had anything too extreme. But I've been near it. I've been worked with a lot of people who are extremely famous, and the amount of attention and rabid, like, crazy people that come out of the woodwork, and it's intense. It's like, that's definitely something you got to learn to cope with. And I've not experienced that, but, like, you know,
I was friends with quite a famous actress, and we'd all gone over to her house for dinner, and when we went in, there was a kind of a guy standing outside, and she was kind of trying to half avoid him, and I could notice that there was some kind of a weird vibe, but we didn't really pay that much attention to it. And then we got inside, and she's like, no, he's here all the time. He just kind of stands outside. And I'm like, shit. And she said, look outside now. And we looked outside, and he was naked. Just standing there, not doing anything, just still looking at the house.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh,
my. Yeah, so that was hot.
Jesse, that could be your next movie. I'm just saying. What? I'd watch that movie if that was a movie.
Yeah, there you go.
All right, now let's...
Good director now.
I think now's a good time to go to the audience for a couple of questions.
Hi.
Hello.
Hey. Hi.
Why?
My question is for Jesse. So I'm a big fan of your work for TV also.
Oh, thank you so much.
Especially Glow. And I was just curious what you see as sort of the big differences in directing for TV versus directing for film.
Oh, well, I mean, I would say the big difference is that the nice thing about TV is, like, as a director, is you get involved with something and it immediately starts, and then in somewhere between a week and 6 weeks later, you're shooting it, which to me is the funnest part of being a director. And then a week later, you're done and you can move on. And so, you know, and doing a film is much more satisfying as a director, because kind of the buck stops with you. If people don't like it, it's your fault. If people like it, you feel a little more responsible for it. But invariably, films are this endless period of development. And then, you know, you prep, and then the shoot seems to go by like that, and you're like, oh my, it's already done, and then you're editing for 5-6 months. So it's just a real different lifestyle thing. For me, I feel incredibly lucky that I'm in a place right now where I can kind of go back and forth, and I'm kind of getting itchy to, like, get another film thing rolling, because I know it'll take probably a year and a half from when I have that beginning of something, so. But.
How about you two? I know you are on Damages, you do get shorty. Do you have, like, a pull towards film more or TV, or is it just sort of you like to do both?
I mean, I do like the immediacy of TV. Not just that, you know, it's going to reach an audience relatively quickly, but I find that the day is very long on a film sometimes, and it's kind of nice to just get through a bunch of pages and then move on. And but shooting films is...
It's a little less precious. TV.
It's a little less precious, yeah. And particularly the precious things about films are generally the aesthetic. And that's not necessarily my primary concern.
What are your primary concerns? What are your primary concerns?
Well, the characterization, the dynamics of the people and all that. So, you know, if the shot looks great, that's cool, but I don't give that much of a shit. So I'm like, well, if you're lighting for an hour and a half, I'm like, you know, it would have been fine with 1 hour of lighting, I think. But then it is lovely being part of a film that just tells an entire story within this certain experience, and so it's kind of like a book like that.
I do think, but when you're doing a series, it's almost like you're in a novel, though, because you're in chapters of someone's life.
Yeah.
And I did love that with Damages. You become, like, so intimate. You become so intimate with the characters. You're doing it all the time. So it does that I used to just love reading the next episode. It was so exciting. Like the next chapter, like what's going to happen? Like I loved it. It was
That's
always
working
really
on a good show. Yeah, and working on a not good show is very different.
That's the main thing.
Damages was a great show.
Something like Damages or Get Shorty or Girls or Glow, or, you know, where it, the material's really good. Like it's really fun. That can be really fun.
Absolutely. Next question.
Hi. Hello. What would you say was the biggest challenge you faced on set?
Don't know.
Biggest challenge, well, physically hiding the pregnancy. That was pretty tough. What else was the biggest
challenge? Creatively, it was trying to make sure that the tone was right. Because you want it to be funny, but you want it to be believable. So just pitching that in the right way, I think, was... was probably the this. It was quite an on-center character for me to play, so it wasn't a huge stretch in that sense. But just trying to make sure that we were pitching it right tonally was probably the biggest challenge. What do you think?
I would agree with that. No. But I felt like weirdly, I felt like there was no real. It didn't feel like it was filled with major tragedies or unsurmountable challenges. For me, the biggest challenge of the movie was getting the music right, because it's such an important part of the story, and it was a kind of daunting thing to have his character worshiping an album and then having to make an album, having to make an album of music that lives up to this character worshiping it. And that probably is the thing that kept me awake the most, and kind of took the most amount of time. Thank you.
And Ethan's actually singing.
He sings all the songs of Tucker Crowe.
Can you be more talented?
Yeah. It was very. I was very surprised how good a singing voice he has, but more importantly, I feel like him as an actor allowed him to, like, even in the ways that his voice isn't perfect, there's like a real like honest emotional quality to. Even the kind of raw, like, vocal performances he did. But.
And one last question before we go.
Hi. My question is pretty specifically for Chris and Rose. Nick Hornby's books are pretty revered. I don't know so much here, but definitely in the UK. How did it feel taking on characters like Annie and Duncan, who so many people just, you know, cling to, and that's their life in some certain way? I know, weirdly enough, I've always identified with Duncan. For kind of what you said, you kind of find yourself making your personality about one thing, and I felt that. So how did it feel taking on roles that you knew people really care about?
It felt good, because it's without being too reductive about it, it feels nice to kind of inhabit a character that people want to watch. You know, that's not necessarily always the case. And I felt like I knew him, so I didn't feel intimidated by the prospect of trying to portray him. And like you say, there's something I love about those kind of fans, that I think the music that you listen to when you're 15 or 16 is the music that will always kind of be important to you. Even if you don't listen to it all the time, it's kind of your touchstone. And it's not just because of the music, it's because it reminds you of who you were at that age. And
totally.
And that's kind of fun, you know? So I felt in terms of, I think Nick does that a lot with his work. And I just did another thing with Nick where I played one of his characters. And I feel that there are these kind of themes that he gets across in his book where these men generally are obsessed with music of some kind, from High Fidelity or About a Boy and this one and the other one. And then the other one, I'm a music critic. So it's obviously because Nick is of all of those things. And then the character who's having a problem with it is somebody who's like the character in the other thing was, she was a doctor for old people, and Annie works in a museum. It's obviously something that he's trying to, like, one of them is obsessed with youth and one of them is obsessed with aging, and it's that kind of battleground in between that it's fun to watch.
Yeah, it's a gift in a way to have the character there, like you said yesterday, Jesse, and But I was intimidated because I'm such a fan of Nick Hornby. So when he came to set and everything, like, I was so nervous. Like, I'm doing an accent and this whole thing. And, like, he's created a character from nothing. Like, this, it's, to me, I just think that's kind of magical. And I'm a real bookworm. And so, but he was so, a lot of writers can be kind of antisocial and awkward, and he is like the opposite. He's warm and funny and self-effacing and like sort of almost like fanish. Like, I'm so excited to be here and see it all happening. And it really put me at ease. So once, it actually helped a lot. Well, after that, I did relax a bit more and go, okay, he seems to be, he's okay, you know, he's all right.
The first time he came to set, though, was...
For you.
Before. Yeah, that's the time
I hadn't met him until, yeah. We were probably a month in, and it was very genuinely, it was a lovely set to be on, and everybody got on great. And then one day, we were just struggling with one scene. I can't even remember what the hell it was, but there was some scene that we were doing that we just couldn't get our heads around. And
we had decided to rewrite a two-line scene. Like, we got...
Oh, that's right.
So we were, like, basically creating a scene, yes, on set.
On the fly.
And it wasn't really working.
And all the crew were there kind of watching us kind of write it as we went. And at some point, I was like, none of this makes any sense. What is this shit? And then hello. And, I went, and Nick was had just walked into the room. And I was like, oh, God, he must think it's like this all the time. But then he was really sweet, and he helped us work it out. So his timing was impeccable.
I would say, is that extra intimidating? Because you do have to take some liberties to make the film, right?
Yeah.
To make the film work, it has to be a little different than the book. So is that intimidating to have him on set at all for that reason?
Well, it wasn't intimidating to have him on set. When I first met him, you know, when I went on a sort of pre-scout trip to London 4 months before, and I had met him, and I felt so guilty that I hadn't had any conversation with him, and I was incredibly nervous about the changes that we had already made. And we just sat down and had drinks, and he and I sort of started apologizing, and he's like, Jesse, I've been involved with so many movies. My wife is a producer. One thing I know for sure is the last thing you need is the input of the novelist to be another thing you got to juggle in making your movies. Like, he's like, I trust you. You just do what you need to do. And then we just segued into a 3-hour argument about whether British music or American music was more important to the history of, like, rock and roll, where he was siding with American music and I was making
plot twist.
Yeah,
I love that.
But if you actually, you know, think about it, like, he really does have a proclivity to, like, the Bruce Springsteen, to that sort of, like, roots rock. You know. Anyways, he was just such an awesome sort of partner and cheerleader, and like Rose said, he came in that one day and just kind of casually, we broke for lunch because we were all paralyzed. Yeah, yeah. We broke for lunch early and sat around, and he just like casually helped us fix the scene. Well, he's a very smart guy.
Yeah, I was gonna say the work he created was amazing, and you guys all did amazing at bringing the story to life. I truly did enjoy the film, and I hope you guys get a chance to go see it. It's in theaters on August 17th. Guys, give it up for Rose, Chris, and Jesse.
Thank you, guys.